Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Shame on you, Ruby, rooting around the house after that mad dog of a man. Ruby, go get the children out of bed and bring them down here. Women are such darn fools. It's a hard world for little things.
Hey, hi, welcome to Ward 13, and I warn you, I am in a bad mood.
Mm-hmm. You're mad as hell, and you're not going to take it anymore. And I'm Matt Connarton.
I am wearing an orange shirt, although you keep saying it's peach,
yeah,
to protest the jackass, the idiot in chief in the White House. And I'm wearing this special yellow tie. It's a Ted Gatz special.
Oh.
The yellow symbolizes Ted's service during Vietnam, where he was a third string football player at UNH, sitting on the bench, keeping Durham safe from the Viet Cong.
He's a great American. And I, of course, am wearing my Merkin, as usual.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
Heather, you're back.
I am. I'm back. Happy to be here.
Why don't you introduce yourself and your son, Cameron?
Okay. Hi. I'm Heather Ouellette-Cygan, and I am the chair of GLSEN New Hampshire, and this is my son, Cameron, who is the co-chair of GLSEN New Hampshire at the moment.
And can you explain, I know you were on a year ago, what is GLSEN?
Oh, yes. So GLSEN is the national organization that works with making schools safe and ensuring safe schools for all, no matter students' sexual orientation, gender identity, or expression. And so we work with schools. We have about 36 chapters around the country, and we are from New Hampshire's chapter.
Very good.
Cameron, why don't you introduce yourself to Ward 13 viewers?
Hi, Cameron Ouellette. I'm the vice chair of GLSEN New Hampshire.
So,
talkative.
Whose name do you enjoy? Is it your mother or your father?
My mother's name.
Okay, because see, when I was, talking to you about, you know, that woman, about whether she was my wife or not, since we couldn't get married.
Yes.
We went to City Hall, we didn't have a divorce decree.
So. I'm still unclear on that, but that's fine. You're very enigmatic that way.
And you said you thought that people should get married if they're going to have children.
Yes.
See, I think that's a bunch of crap. But I think that a child should have the mother's name.
Really?
Well, she has to go through the labor and everything, and I've always believed that.
Well, I think that, you know, I don't think there should be any kind of rule about
Why?
It. I think the couple should decide whoever's...
Well, I'm a left-winger, so I believe in regulation.
Well, a lot of couples will assign, they'll do the hyphen for
So you're
child.
An Ouellette.
Yes.
We have got Glenn R.J. Ouellette next door.
Are you related to the people's mayor?
Glenn R.J.?
I am not.
Oh.
As far as I know. There's a lot of us in the state.
He's an important and powerful man.
Is Glenn from Quebec, or did he just go to school there?
No, he's from... Well, he was born on the bridge. That's
you know,
why he has dual citizenship.
Bridge?
Yeah. That's what he claims.
I've heard many stories about that.
About Glenn,
but
or
they
just...
are not for the family hour. And we can't get the show at 10 o'clock.
What do you mean they're not? Who's not for the family hour?
About the international bridge. Oh. Heather, what... Oh, my God. What does it feel like to be the mother of any child with the idiot-in-chief in the White House, that jackass Donald John Trump?
Well, it's a little scary for a number of reasons. I have two children. I also have a daughter, Zoe, and she's a girl, so...
So
I'm worried about that. I'm worried...
Just keep him away from the idiot-in-chief.
Yeah. I think the biggest problem, the scariest thing to me out of everything is just the disdain for the environment. So,
that's all?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the biggest
truth,
thing. Because, well, all of those things, but I just think if we don't take care of this planet, none of the other things are going to matter anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So not gay rights, not gender equality, not, you know, school. ISIS, none of it's going to matter.
You know what gets my goat, and I was supposed to vent before the show, as I told Matt.
I hope you find your goat. My goodness.
Is if you were, say, in the Cold War, spying on the old Soviet Union, and something might have happened to you, which, once again, you're having a health scare, that means you might be dead soon, and your partner's dead, and then you find the Manchurian candidate is in the White House. It makes you feel like a Vietnam veteran betrayed.
Is that all?
I'm just getting it out right now. You know, I went to the Vet Center today. It's in Hooksett. It's for, you know, like counseling for veterans. And it has a thing over the doorway. Oh, through these doors, the very best come through. Then I find out I'm not a warrior. I am not a veteran that, you know, qualifies for their counseling. Which the people would tell me is better than the VA.
Really?
And I just wonder, if I was 5,000 miles in the rear with the gear, like Al Baldessaro, or somebody like that.
I don't know what that means in the rear with the gear. What
does that mean? You're not anywhere near combat.
Oh, gotcha.
And then I get what I happen spying on the Russians. Well, that just doesn't count. I'm not a warrior. Mm. And I just think about America. America loves to classify everybody, in the words of the idiot in chief, Donald Trump, losers. I guess I'm a loser. What do you think about that, Heather? About people that suddenly are gay, lesbian, bisexual, lesbian and transgender people are being reclassified, are they not? Just recently.
Yeah, we're worried. I mean, the most recent news out of the White House is that it's rumored that the White House is going to stop enforcing protections for transgender students that are linked to Title IX. And so, obviously, this creates a lot of anxiety for students in schools, for everything from, you know, equal participation in sports or
right.
Where they're going to go to the bathroom.
Title IX is Title IX of the 1968 Civil Rights Act, which in the 90s, under Bill Clinton, they started expanding. So a school like Boston University was supposed to have equal programs for both men and women, so that idiot John Sober of BU, Reagan's favorite Democrat, abolished the football team rather than give equity to women's sports.
Oh, interesting. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Title IX was expanded, I guess, under Obama to embrace it.
Yeah, to protect students at school. So allowing a student to use the bathroom that he or she felt comfortable using that matched their gender identity. Locker rooms, you know, a lot of issues that cisgendered people don't have to worry about, but a
right.
transgender student does.
Unless a cisgender, when you're in freshman year and the big guys are in there ready to get trimming, you know.
Now, that's a term that not everyone might know, because we just started hearing that relatively recently, that term cisgendered. So what does that mean exactly?
Cisgender, you want to explain? You're not talking much.
No. cisgender means that you're somebody
Move that mic. Well, you can move it this way a little bit. Right. We just want to make sure we can hear you.
And no doing this, which I love to do.
Right, yeah, no tapping.
Basically, cisgender means that you align with the gender that you were given at birth. So when you were born and they assigned you as a male, you grew up and you stuck with that. It's kind of the opposite of transgender.
Okay. We've talked on this show about one of the few groups, if you want to say that Trump has not really gone out of his way to offend, is, you know, LGBTQ.
Until recently.
Well, you don't think, though, because you've said that, I mean, his hero was Roy Cohn. You've said you don't think he's homophobic.
Roy Cohn was this nasty mafia-connected lawyer who made his reputation with Joe McCarthy. Mm-hmm. He helped Donald John Trump land the hotel in 1974, the hotel at Grand Central Station, which was threatened with demolition, just like the old Pennsylvania Station, which is gone. But Jackie Onassis, you know, threw her weight behind it.
Oh,
Jackie O. We hardly knew ye. But I remember her. I think you're much too young. And he was given a $278 million loan from the city of New York, which was headed by Abe Beam, a Tammany Hall hack. Mm-hmm. And that's what helped make him his fortune. And the guy in the Beam administration who helped get him the deal went to work for Roy Cohn. Mm-hmm. Roy Cohn was disbarred. He was a mob lawyer, very famous. And Donald John Trump, that was like a surrogate father to him. And they had a picture, he had a picture of him, but then he was outed as gay when he was dying of AIDS. He's in Angels in America, he's the character. He's that character. Ron Liebman was an excellent actor, played him on Broadway, he's the nasty guy he was. But when Pacino played him, he played him with a lot more humanity.
Well, James Woods played him too in a film. I can't remember
Yeah. But Citizen Kane.
Yes, yes.
Very nasty guy. A mob lawyer who got the, so that was his mentor. But like we were saying, he's never been, and I've had friends of mine who are gay Republicans say, oh, well, he's not homophobic. But, you know.
I get the impression he has no particular opinions
on
the matter, which means he may be, you never know what direction he may be pulled in.
He has no central identity. He's mentally ill.
Right. Well, other than suspect you're correct.
Increasingly so.
There was a rumor as he was moving so quickly the first couple of weeks that one of the plans was to undo protections that the Obama administration had offered to LGBT folks, mm-hmm. Federal employees and that sort of thing. And then, so among the community, people were getting very upset and talking about that. And then the rumor, and then they came forward and said, oh no, we're not going to do that. And the rumor is that Ivanka went and talked to him and said, Dad, that's not a good idea.
Well, it sounds like she's the liberal of the family. Yeah. I mean, I might be reading too much into it, but that's the impression.
Yeah, but Steve Bannon is the assistant president.
Yeah. True.
And now he's moved against,
Bannon's probably more powerful than Pence. Not that VPs are always very powerful. Sometimes
they're
not.
That's very true,
yeah.
Well, Pence will have his time in about a year.
May or less. Yeah, I agree.
Although, you see, the Democrats are trying to stop any talk of impeachment this early because they want to get
which is smart.
A big landslide in 2018.
Yep.
But I guess this White House leaks like no other White House except like Nixon in 74. The Republicans are going to go along with Trump is going to use budget calculus not used since Reagan, where like you take the budget instead of 8 years, you put it 10.
Right.
And then you do all these, blue skies and sunshine, like any hustler would do. And they're going to ram it through so none of the Republicans really have to vote against Social Security and stuff before 2018. And they've actually talked about, this actually violates laws passed during when Clinton was president, that you didn't have this BS going on.
Right.
They're going to try to balance the budget. Because Republicans talked one game, like on immigration, then we'll do everything they can to make as many immigrants here, to bust unions, lower wages, whatever, and then cry havoc, But they've also said they're ready to remove the Senate's parliamentarian if they rule that this violates the law. That the Republicans now are so far in with this idiot in chief, they're willing to break the law. Because who's going to stop them? They control. They have to vote for the impeachment. It's the House. And then the Senate has to convict. Mm-hmm. So we might, with LGBT, just seeing the beginning of the wedge. They're being very careful because Idjit has really had a disastrous 30 days. Well, how long is it? 21 days?
Oh, it feels like so much longer.
Sounds like a year.
No, doesn't it? It's been
it feels like years. It feels like we're halfway through his first term at least.
Cameron, 57 years old, and the only thing you can think of is Nixon at the very end.
Really?
This isn't Nixon, who was a congressman, a senator, a vice president, and a very a distinguished lawyer, a Supreme Court advocate.
And he was not a crook. Just ask him.
No.
He said that.
That's right.
But, that's what we need, a billionaire in the Oval Office,
Of course.
And to bring in a group of crooks. But
who understands the economy better than a billionaire? That's why everyone who's ever studied economics is a billionaire, right?
Yeah, that's why he went through 7 bankruptcies.
That's right.
We will have a show about the Babylonian lottery sometime later.
Sounds exciting. You got to be in it to win it.
How do you know Spanish?
No.
Okay. I think I mispronounced Jorge Luis Borges. Do you pronounce the G as hard?
No. Jorge? I never did. I took 3 years of Spanish.
Borges.
Yeah.
Well, he's a great writer.
He took French.
Hey.
He's a French.
Yeah.
Oh.
You can see I'm in a good mood. Hey. You're smiling. You look happy. Tell us, what's on your mind?
What do you want to talk about, Cam?
Oh, jeez. I don't even know.
How old are you, Cam?
I'm going to be 25 next month.
So, 25, you were born in 1992.
Yes.
When George H.W. Bush was president. So, Bill Clinton is probably you remember.
A little bit.
Yeah. And then that other horse's ass from the Bush's family. But then you had Obama.
Who seems downright statesmanlike now.
He does.
He really does.
Who would ever think, we were talking about this, that you'd want W back and Dick Cheney?
You know what's funny about that, too? During W's administration, even a lot of very liberal Democrats were saying, George H.W. Bush wasn't so bad. Kind of miss him. And so it just continues.
Yeah.
As we continue to devolve.
So in your When was I 25? Oh, 1984 when Dutch Reagan ran for re-election. Dutch Reagan was, had Alzheimer's disease, and, you know. We were talking about various things. In the 1981 inauguration, they had a minstrel show, which you just expunged from history.
I didn't know. I had no idea until John told me
this. I didn't know that either.
Yeah. Ben Vereen was in blackface singing the Robert E. Lee. And I remember being, I was 22. Watching that, it was like, geez, it's time to give up marijuana. Time to give up the pot.
Yeah.
Then in 84, the first debate, he was so obviously mentally gone. It was shocking.
Was that where he had that moment where he...
Moment. It was all moments.
Well, there was a particular moment, though, where he kind of stumbled and he was quiet for, like, an uncomfortably long time while he was trying to gather his thoughts.
Right.
Was that 84?
Yeah, then they doped him up with whatever, packed him with blood or everything.
Yeah.
But here you are. You're in a military intelligence unit where you can actually send a message to the president.
Yeah.
And I did that twice. I actually ran the thing through, and we'd laugh, you know. Look what's going through. He'll never read it. And then you're watching a news conference during Irangate, and he's talking gibberish.
Yeah.
Real gibberish. And it turned out Gary Wills, who won the Pulitzer Prize, pointed out that it was a 1939 Brass Bancroft T-Man serial that Ronald Reagan was, that's what he was talking about. And everybody just pretended this isn't happening, you know, that you have somebody that had Alzheimer's as the president of the United States, which pretty much shows you the presidency that was Jim Baker and people that run it. But now, I'm saying, Karen, I can't. I'm still in shock.
Yeah, but you got to say this for him. The man knew how to use Brill Cream.
Yeah, I actually saw him. I actually met him. The two most charismatic people I ever met were Bill Clinton and Dutch.
No kidding, yeah.
But, you know... Yeah, but I'm just flabbergasted, folks. I can't believe this is the president of the United States. He's the Manchurian Candidate, great movie from '62. Mm-hmm. And now it's the Russian ambassador to the UN died. At first, I thought it was the Russian ambassador.
Oh.
Because before the November election, the Russian ambassador to the United States announced twice that he'd met with not only Trump organization people, but with one of the Trump sons.
Mm-hmm.
But somehow it escapes people. So, Cameron, what do you think about your new president? Well, I'm going through some type of meltdown like the Wicked Witch of the West.
I just try to laugh and embrace the horror, you know.
No,
I think it's hilarious.
I feel like we're living a horror show.
Yeah.
And, Pretty. I think I'm more upset about people just sweeping everything under the rug and kind of ignoring everything as it's going along. Because it's a horror show. We can't keep going on with this. Can't ignore it. So, but, I mean.
Thing that's going on is he's giving a license to just the expression of hatred. Mm. I'm up at the VA, and a person that's like running a group therapy thinks they can use a racist comment about Muslims. Which you're not supposed to do with veterans that are coming back from...
Of course.
You know, because they're the other, and, you know...
Right.
Those were civilians. A lot of those people were civilians forced to do things that they had to...
Well, not only that, but a lot of Muslims serve in the American military.
Yes, but the Donald J...
They're the good ones? Is that what it is? Yeah, that must be what it is.
So what is Glisten doing right now to...
We are... trying to position ourselves to be there to support schools. So we figure, you know, we're not going to make a lot of progress at the upper levels right now. So it's really more about being local action, grassroots action. So getting into schools, helping school boards, you know, to enact policies that are going to protect students, because there certainly is an uptick in LGBT bullying that's happening in schools right now, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And, you know, what are we going to do to support students who are in schools where they're, you know, transgender students who are afraid that now they're not going to be allowed to continue using the bathroom that they feel comfortable in or playing the sport that they're playing, having, you know, their identity protected or the name that they prefer being used. So... Glisten, at this, we're positioning ourselves really to support schools at the local level.
How long has this organization existed?
We just had our 25th anniversary in 2015.
Wow.
So 27 years.
Okay.
Yeah. Started in Boston.
No kidding. See, I was never even aware of it until the first time that you came on the show. Mm. But I suppose it makes sense in a way, because as these issues are being talked about more and more, and really coming to the forefront, that is it a national organization or just
it is?
It is, okay.
Yeah. So we work on policy in Washington D.C. and then so we have our policy folks are located there, and then the chapter, the people who support the different chapters throughout the country, are located in New York City.
Is there a chapter in every state?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. We have about 36 chapters. Most of New England has a chapter, but not Vermont, which always seems weird.
Yeah, that is weird.
Yeah. And I don't think Rhode Island.
I think it's Pennsylvania. They don't have.
Pennsylvania doesn't have.
No.
I would guess, maybe this isn't fair, but I would, tell me if I'm right or wrong, I would guess that maybe some of the southern states are also some of the places lacking. Am I right?
It's a lot of the Midwest.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
The southern, I think, especially Tennessee and Georgia have?
Yeah, Atlanta.
Yep. Atlanta, yeah. So
Florida has two of them.
Yeah, Florida has two. So Kentucky, yes, Glisten Bluegrass is fairly new. So there are a lot of people down there who are organizing, you know, and they face very different situations in their schools. Clearly, they don't have, I think, students in New England and on the West Coast experience much better situations at school because they have supportive adults, supportive administration. A lot of schools have moved to have policies that are, you know, enumerated language in an anti-bullying policy that specifically protects gay and lesbian students and those sorts of things, and policies for how transgender rights will be protected at the school level.
You say there's been an uptick in bullying and whatnot. What do you think is driving that? Or any theories? I mean, it's easy to say, oh, yeah, I didn't blame Trump or whatever, but it's got to be more complicated than that.
Yeah,
I would think.
I think a lot of what I've heard is stemmed from the presidency.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Wow.
A lot of people feel it just a license to be, like a lot of people, I'd like to say, you know, they had to go in the closet for a while.
Yeah.
And they didn't like it. And now I think they have they have role models in powerful positions that are not treating people well. And so they're feeling more entitled to do that.
Yeah. It's a more toxic environment, I guess. It's funny too, because there was an interview back during the campaign. Trump was talking with, it was Chris Matthews on MSNBC, and the bathroom bill in North Carolina came up, and Trump was like, I don't, you know, he seemed like, you know, I don't even care about this issue. What's the big deal was his
but it is
his
a big deal to Bannon and his people.
True.
And look at here. I don't know if, Kristen, you can put what's on the screen on our screen. You know, the screen on
the computer monitor?
Computer. We had an incident here, care of Richard H. Gerard, accusing me and Ray Buckley, of all people, of handing out flyers and candy saying the pedophiles are coming because of they were going to vote on unisex bathrooms and protections for transgendered people. So he puts my face on this stuff. Yeah, Ray Buckley's got enough time to go around candy handing out flyers. And it turns out to be this right-wing... low church Protestant, white light Protestant, gospel church right around the corner that's doing it.
Yeah.
That, you know, they're homophobes. This is on New Hampshire Family Radio, Richard H. Gerard, which is part of the American Family Radio, which the Southern Poverty Law Center says is an anti-gay hate group.
Oh, you agree that I say that too. Yeah, absolutely.
And this is
Brian Fisher. Yeah,
H.
absolutely.
Gerard of the school board, who, in the perversity of the school board, they give him the head of like diversity and stuff. This hate monger, this racist.
Right.
And it's just unbelievable. But if she puts it up there, you know, suddenly, so if you go look at me, if I'm trying to get a job, I'm handing out the pedophile flyers, you know, at the Gerard at Large website.
Yeah.
You know, Gerard at Large is a hateful, pathetic liar.
He's a good Christian, though. That's the important
thing. Oh, yes. He's a good, you know, every Catholic I've ever known, including my family members, always say they're Catholic. But when we caught him with his pants down trying to go after this mentally challenged woman, it made him a better Christian. Mm-hmm. I mean, persecution.
Because he learned from it. It's a
transgression makes you a better Christian.
A teachable moment, if you will.
And Kirsten, I'm going to bring up in a second the actual disgusting flyer.
Oh.
I mean, this is hate.
I haven't even seen it. Now, did this go up on this site recently?
Oh, the Union Leader had it, too. We can go to the Union Leader.
Oh.
Look at this disgusting.
Pedophiles are coming, warning.
Look at this disgusting. Pedophiles are coming, warning parents. School board meeting. And then go to my blog, Anne-Marie Banfield, who's one of these right-wing Christian anti-gay people.
Right.
And he said, they're trying to make me that I'm handing these out.
See, the way this flyer is written, though, it to me it looks like it's saying pedophiles are coming to the school board meeting, which I would think would make people want to stay away from the school board meeting. I mean, you know, it's important to be involved in the school board, but if there's going to be pedophiles there, I don't want to be there. That's gross.
Let's have the thing up again. Pedophiles are coming, warning parents, school board, but to discuss a policy that would allow boys and girls to use the same bathrooms and showers.
See, I don't want... I don't,
oh, my head!
I don't want pedophiles discussing that policy, or any policy. That's upsetting to me. I can see why this is offensive.
Then that jackass, Gerard, puts my name on the thing.
Well, do you want pedophiles at the school board, John? Come on, you got to take a stand.
No, I don't want to see Richard J. Gerard on the school board. But for different reasons. Because he's a hate monger, an anti-gay hate monger. It's disgusting. It's disgusting. And I've seen, since Trump, on that board, people think they can say, Carol Shea Porter's one reason to be against her is her husband's black. Now, I've met Gene, and he's not an African-American that I know of or anything. But they think that they can say something like that. Being black is a reason to be against Carol Shea Porter. That's recently. Now I got to go on to a social media site, and any liberal Democrat that could criticize this coward Trump with his five of deferments and then a 4F, he went to the Queen's Board to get a 4F, is a traitor to this country. I told one of the people, I'll tell you what, I'll bring my friend, I'm going to call him Harry, who you met, who is a Vietnam combat veteran and a liberal Democrat. And I'll bring him on a show and tell him he's a traitor. But, of course, we might lose some of the stuff around here. It's just crazy how people are saying. And I told that person on his social media, this is beneath you. But this jackass Trump is allowing hate. You know, this is actually hate. If you ever thought or questioned that there's such a thing as hate speech, you can see it now. Because most people are too young to remember that. You know, the word that begins with an N and ends in an R is actually hate, and it does hurt people. Mm-hmm. You might have a First Amendment right to say it, but it hurts people. Because I have African-American friends.
Yeah.
They're closest to me.
Yeah,
and
of course.
And it hurts.
Of course.
And it also signals when somebody puts that up that it's dangerous, that there's danger. Is it not?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Anti-gay violence in the 70s and was tremendous, you know, in the 80s. When I was in San Francisco, of all places, a gay guy that was in my creative writing class at Berkeley, he got off at the wrong stop in Oakland and was beaten to death.
Oh, God.
And that's
1993
or 4.
Wow.
You know?
I tend to think... And maybe we're seeing a reversal of this, unfortunately. My perception, though, has always been throughout my life that just bigotry in general, it gets better with every generation, that every generation is less, cares less about that as society becomes more diverse, as we become more integrated.
Or they hide it.
Some, yes. But I think some, I like to think, the optimist in me likes to think that genuinely it does get better with each generation.
I just rolled my eyes.
But I hope, you're much more cynical than I am, John.
Yeah, because in 1979, my father lived in a gated community in Birmingham, Alabama.
Right.
And a football player, high school football player, came to visit his mother, who was a maid, and he wasn't out by 5 o'clock, which is, there always was this thing, and be out by...
Right.
By... sundown.
Right.
And he was shot to death. My father moved out of Alabama right after that.
Yeah.
And he was a Democrat and a liberal, but since he was born in like 26, he wasn't as bleeding hard as I might be.
But that was 1979.
So
I'm just saying, I think overall, in the macro, it gets better with every generation.
Well, we just had the clock set back, didn't we?
Well, that's what I'm concerned about, that we are backsliding.
Tell us, you know, you have a lot of friends in the alt-right movement. He said, I'm just playing with him now. Yeah. Tell me about the massacre in Sweden.
Oh. you know what?
Tell me about the massacre at, was it Bowling Green?
Bowling Green. The Bowling Green Massacre, yes.
And I'll tell you what it's like to go to the Exit 10 Diner in Newtown, Connecticut. And Newtown, I lived in Danbury, that's the next town over. Sandy Hook's the village there. And look at the crayon drawings from the children mourning the dead, what that's like. Why doesn't Trump talk about that massacre? Why doesn't he talk about what happened in the Murrah building in Oklahoma City? And that girl would be 23 years old now. Remember the picture?
I know why he doesn't talk about Sandy Hook. That's easy, because Trump's a conspiracy theorist. We have our first conspiracy theorist president, and they don't believe Sandy Hook actually happened.
And Sandy Hook, the ban on assault weapons, which I was in the NRA and all that stuff, that was in response to 38 people killed in Stockton in 1998. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a you want massacres. The Cato Institute, which is a conservative think tank, some of the stuff of Obamacare is from the Cato Institute because that's a free market-based conservative approach.
I thought it was from the Heritage Foundation.
Oh, Heritage, you're right. But, you know, they're similar.
But I understand
they became mainstream.
Saying. Right, right.
They wrote recently, in the 40 years from 75 to 2015, there were 200 refugees that, there was 20 refugees in all that time, 40 years, that actually tried to commit a terrorist offense. Only 3 succeeded, and they were Cuban.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
You'll never hear that.
As well.
In like 1976, Cubans based in Miami destroyed a Cuban airliner and killed almost 100 people, and they still are let free in the United States because of the Cuban bloc and the Republicans. So when they talk about, you know, it's just through the, it's beyond Orwell.
Mm.
It's like through the looking glass. The first time in my life, I'm glad I didn't have kids. I hate to say that.
I'm glad I didn't have kids every day of my life.
Well.
No offense. I'm sure you're a wonderful son here to Heather. Well, you gotta like take care of him and stuff. Like it looks like a lot of work.
It is a lot of work.
Yes.
But he's gonna take care of her when she's.
That's true.
Oh, that's true.
The wheelchair.
Oh, I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, Cameron and his husband will take care of me.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right.
Are you married, Cameron?
No.
Not yet.
Not yet.
Yeah, you're old. How old are you?
I'm gonna be 25.